Can't do it. Oh, there we are. Can you guys see me and hear me? Just give me a thumbs up or say hi. Hi, guys. Oh, yeah. Okay, perfect. Good. I was just trying to upload it or I was just trying to go live and it wasn't working. I was like, oh no. Welcome, guys. It's really nice to see everybody here and from all parts of the world. I thought by doing a later time, actually, that some of the Southeast folks, Southeast Asian folks might not be able to participate. I didn't do that on purpose. It's just that I had only time in the afternoon, but it looks like there are a nice contingent of Southeast Asian folks here. So welcome, guys. Very nice to see all of you. I am battling a little bit of sunlight here, so I'm a little bit blown out and I apologize for that. But I want to just actually say thank you for attending. And I'm going to try to do this video mainly on some of the answers that maybe I haven't answered for the Flock Finger Lakes. It's obviously a new venture, a new channel, a new stage of life. And I think a lot of folks are actually interested in that kind of a similar arrangement. So it would be kind of cool to share some of my limited knowledge and the experiences that we're drawing together. And I also wanted to answer some questions right off the bat, because I had some questions that came in via direct message. And Jay, I want to get to your question beforehand because it's a little unrelated to today. But Jay asked if there's an opportunity to take a smaller course versus the masterclass. And I do a number of courses online. There's Houseplant Basics, which is a really basic introductory level course. It's like a mini course. So it's the idea behind that is if you are just starting into plants, then you could take that. And there's an automatic upgrade into the masterclass if you want to do that. So you could actually dip your toe in the water with that. And then I have one called Troubleshoot Your Houseplants. And that one specifically goes into cultural and diseases and nutritional deficiencies in plants. And that one, you could also have an automatic upgrade into the masterclass. And again, that is another mini course. So you could take smaller courses and then upgrade into the masterclass if you want to do that. So you don't have to take the entire masterclass if you don't want to. And then there's the 125 houseplant care spreadsheet. And that's for folks who just really like to be extremely organized and have a place that they could go where they could track their plants for lighting and water. And it's kind of one of those like really quick Cliff's Notes versions, but done in a spreadsheet format. And that's how I keep like a lot of the stuff clear in my head when you start getting more than one plant in your house. Anyway, so hopefully that answered your question. And for I think the masterclass and Troubleshoot Your Houseplants, because we're celebrating our fourth year anniversary on Plant One On Me, I decided to do a little sale on those. So you could use the code 4 years, the number 4 years, and then you'll get a discount on those courses as well. So hi guys, everybody. I'm going to be reading Scotland, Ireland, Kurdistan. Oh my God. Shamam, did you hear about me through Joey's work or no? I'm just out of curiosity since you're from Kurdistan. It would be really nice to know if that is a connection. Hi, Toby from the UK and a lot of Brooklyn folks there. Really nice to see all of you. So I'm going to answer some more questions because the other question I got is from Jasmine Schmidt. I don't know if she's here right now. She said, I just got an internship through Student Conservation Association for hemlock preservation in Taconic Falls until Christmas. Can you recommend good weekend excursions in the area? So one thing I really love about this area is that it is, and I'm talking about the Finger Lakes area here in New York, is that it's just geologically rich with so much beautiful landscapes. And Taconic Falls, if you're not familiar with it, you've probably obviously heard of Niagara Falls, which is the biggest falls, but Taconic Falls is the tallest falls east of the Mississippi. And that's a really gorgeous area. I mean, weekend excursions, if you love to hike, there's almost, I would say there's over 200 miles of amazing hiking trails just within that area. So, and then the towns of like Brooktondale, Ithaca, you know, Dryden, you could go to any of those towns. They have like really great restaurants. Many of the folks here are very international, and it's largely because in the universities, over half of the students that come into the universities, specifically Cornell University, are international students. So you could get a lot of like great international food here. So you're not only going to get great farm to table food, but you're going to get like Ethiopian and all different types of Asian cuisines, including like Indian and Cambodian and Burmese. there's a lot of amazing things that you could do. Sinanopolis is around, so you could have like movie nights. And of course, like things have kind of shut down a little bit for COVID, but I think things are going to start picking up again in the spring and summer. So those are all great places to kind of consider if you're coming out this way. Very exciting. And I wanted to mention that you are doing something with the Student Conservation Association, because maybe some people on here will take a look at the Student Conservation Association and see if that's something that's meaningful for them. All right, I'm going to shout out a lot of the folks who are here today: Buffalo, Los Angeles, Holland, London, Seattle, Denmark, Michigan, Washington, Toronto, Singapore, Philly, Brooklyn. Guys are such a great international contingent here. Okay, so let's see what else we have. Gabriel, so how many plants are you planning to take with you, and what are you going to do with the ones that you currently have back home in New York? So you probably see that we have some plants that are starting to proliferate in this place. Most of these are Saunders, because he's actually living here full time. So if you saw the house tour that we did, you'll start to notice that he has some plants, including this Zamioclocus zamiifolia raven here. Those are all of his plants. My plan is to bring some here, but this place needs to be renovated. And one of the only times that I really felt stressed in my life with my plants in my house was when my house in Brooklyn was actually getting renovated. So I don't really want to bring plants here knowing that we're going to go under a renovation. So I don't live here full time. I'm kind of just traveling here back and forth and trying to get things set up. And I'm basically splitting my time, and I'm taking one day at a time. So I don't go long enough for my plants to suffer at this point. I think as we start to approach the summer months, when watering needs are more frequent, I will actually have to hire somebody to come and take care of my plants. But right now, I'm not planning on moving too many. My hopes and my plans, or I should say our hopes and our plans, are to actually get a greenhouse here and to build a greenhouse. And I think that's a really fun and exciting project. There's a number of our friends out here who have greenhouses, which is a bit more challenging in this area because we get a lot of snow and there's a lot of winter. So one of our friends is actually building a huge greenhouse at the moment, which will be a future episode on Flock Finger Lakes. So you'll have to tune into that. And I think there's going to be a lot of learnings from that. So when we actually go out and we film on other people's places, we're also doing it through the lens of like, is that interesting for us to do? Or what can we learn from that experience and apply in our land? And hopefully you can learn from that experience as well. And you could take that information and say, oh, is this something that I might want to do in the future? That's a kind of an interesting thing. So hopefully that answered your question. But yeah, I'd love to start filling this place with plants. One of our ideas, if you could see this wall, has these kind of black things in the back. They're speakers, actually. One of our ideas is to actually cover that wall as a green wall, that whole wall, because what you can't see is you see the light coming in. It's facing a very large curtain window that's almost directly facing south. So it gets a ton of light. But I would say it's probably 20 feet away from the window. But the light really comes in, and I think that we could grow a lot of nice tropical foliage plants as a green wall. So we're looking at different green wall options for this wall, and that will probably be something that we will cover in the future on Plant One On Me. All right. So Davy Doodles DIY Network says, "Hey Summer, I have a house chicken too. And I was wondering how you keep your chicken from pooping everywhere." You know, you can put your chicken in a diaper, but not all, for those of you who never heard, like, chicken diapers, they exist. You can put your chicken in a diaper, but mine never really liked a diaper. You might have to try them, like try the diaper on them when they're like just babies and then they get used to it. But, you know, Kippy, and when I had Vita, she never really liked being in a diaper. So essentially you don't prevent them. I had to like roll up all my carpets, and Kippy was very good. She never really defecated on anything that was soft. Sometimes she did, but it was very rare. So, and I got really used to like my chicken's bowel movements. So she would get up if she was sleeping, and then all of a sudden she'd get up. And I knew at that moment that she had to go to the bathroom. So I would bring her down to the ground, and I would just, I never used so many paper towels in my life. I wasn't even somebody who purchased a lot of paper towels. And with a chicken indoors, you just use a lot of paper towels. And then at night, she liked to sleep on top of the door. And so we basically got, we put the door out and had a little stopper so the door wouldn't move, and built an extra 2 inches on the door top so she could, like, chickens prefer to nest and roost on a flat surface because their feet are flat. So a lot of people will give them like a round pole, like a parrot or a parakeet, but that's not good for their feet. So we had like a 2-inch thing that she like put her little hands over, and then we called it a poop hammock. Basically created this little hammock and a little arm that came out from the door and had these 2 towels with paper towels on it. So at night when she went to the bathroom, it just got caught so it didn't like drop to the ground. There's just clever ways of thinking about it. And honestly, I would think that chickens would be such good house pets if they didn't poop so often. But just be mindful that Kippy had the best of both worlds. She was both outdoors and indoors. So it basically got to the point where I would have her outdoors in the coop with the Los Sures hens, which is the senior center hens that I take care of. And then at night she would just expect to come home because she was like that. And she didn't like to go out like during the rain or the snow. She would prefer to stay in. So those were the only exceptions. But typically I would recommend that, like, chickens really love to be, they're social creatures. They have really dynamic and complex social relationships. So having them with other chickens or being around humans all the time, I think is actually a benefit for them because they have those like really deep relationships, which is really neat to see. Okay, so Alexandra asks, when will you get a new chicken? I did get a new chicken. Actually, technically her name is Leche. And my plan was to actually bring her up here and to have the coop, but it started snowing like almost immediately since we got here. There were a few things that we got filmed before we got pummeled with snow, and we couldn't finish the coop that we wanted to do here. But I ended up getting a foster hen, same place where I got Kippy, which is the Wild Bird Fund. It was a discarded chicken, and brought her in. Her name was Leche. And I introduced her to the Los Sures coop, the senior center that I volunteer at. And she just took to those hens right away. And she's like total boss lady. And she just really loves being in that coop. And so I think I'm going to have a hard time getting her out because I don't want to, again, ruin that dynamic that she has with the other chickens right now. But as, you know, my friends are saying here, there's so many other chickens that need homes. So I think, you know, maybe in the spring, maybe in the summer, when we could actually get the coop, you know, finished and working, we'll get some, like, a nice little flock of hens up here. So Mercer Lewis asks, on this note, will there be any animals up there and with you guys bringing you at the, in the flock? And I think the answer is like, yes. The short answer is yes. We're going to probably concentrate on birds first because it's what we have, you know, what we really love. So this area has a lot of ponds and it might be something that we could look into getting ducks as well, which would be fun. Our other partner, Joey, loves ducks. He says he doesn't think chickens are so cute, but he thinks ducks are cute, but I think they're both really amazing. So we'll take a look into that, but I'm not gonna be here full time until we probably start building a bit more. So I can't expect my one partner to do all the work. So we're gonna kind of take it a day at a time. And it was a little rushed for me to end up taking Leche the hen without a like total game plan, but you know, it ended up working out, and I think that's what helps, like taking everything a day at a time. So Tarquin Crisp, I'm sorry if I like completely misconstruing your name. Will you grow a food forest, and if so, what will you plant? And hello from London. The idea is yes, we really want to grow a food forest here. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the elder ash borer, but okay, so we got here in the fall. So basically almost none of the trees, the deciduous trees, had leaves on them. So it's a little bit harder to identify what trees they are. Though we did a good walk through the forest and we have some really amazing shagbark hickory, white oak, red oak. So we got some nut producing, nut bearing trees, but we have white, I think we have white ash, and the elder ash borer has literally decimated all the ash trees. You'll notice them as you come up because they have something called blonding. So that's where the emerald ash borer larva is just underneath the bark, surface of the bark. And woodpeckers and other birds will go in and start removing the bark. So then we have trees with like that are completely barkless. And we have a ton of woodpeckers up here, by the way. So they're just taking all this larvae out from the trees, and then the trees are just dying. And it's unfortunate because ash is one of the principal trees that have been used throughout history to make baskets for basket weaving. There's nothing else like ash. It's a very hard wood, so people use it to make baseball bats and things like that. So it's really a shame to see such a wonderful species in the forest go. But what that affords then is as they start to go, light opens up in the forest, and we're planning to kind of remove some of these trees. And I'd like to start growing some more unusual plantings. So we could plant hazelnuts. We could plant persimmons. I'd love to plant, oh my God, why am I blanking on the name? Oh, I'm totally blanking on the name. The nice pawpaws, yeah. Sonner, I'm like, oh my God. Pawpaws are like the number one thing I was like actually wanted to plant in that area. And just kind of diversify within the forest. Sorry, I'm blocking the sun coming in. There's an area, a strip of land, you'll actually see it because we're doing a property tour this week. And there's just a strip that's between field and like the forest. And I think we'll just probably clear some of that out. We won't have to clear a lot of it because it's pretty much cleared. And unfortunately, some of the ash is now dying back. We'll leave some of those snags for the animals because there's clearly a lot of birds and chipmunks and squirrels and everything that live in some of those trees. So we'll be very selective. And our hope was this at the end of this year, this past year, we were hoping to walk through with a forester to get a sense of what we might actually cut down to increase the health of the forest. But again, we didn't get a chance to do that with the craziness of the snow here. Okay. I just took a trip up to Kristen Shaw. I just took a trip to Logie's and bought some plants that need to be a bit warmer than my house is normally. Any tips for keeping plants warmer in the winter? I'm in Connecticut, so it's a bit chilly. I don't know how big your plants are, but whenever there's a plant that I want to maintain more of the heat, I just try to put it in a terrarium. It's really hard. As you start to get bigger and bigger glass, it gets more and more expensive, unfortunately. I had this big vase of roses that I got like eons ago, and it was huge. And I just turned that upside down and turned that into a greenhouse for my Aglaonema pictum tricolor. It's just an easier way to kind of create a little bit more of a greenhouse condition for your plants. Oh, that's obviously more challenging if it's a large plant, like if you have a large citrus or if it starts to grow outside of that. Otherwise, you might be able to get one of those. I've seen them in places like gardeners.com or like greenhouse megastore, things like that. It's almost like a plastic greenhouse that you could put on the side of your wall if you want to like make space for that in your house. And it's like has a zip front and things like that. But it's small enough that you could do it inside your house. And it's probably really good for starting like plant starts or propagating or doing seed starting. And you might also want to try, especially on the note of seed starting, since I just mentioned it, you could also get heating mats, and you could just plug them in and they'll just get slightly warmer. Like they'll get like whatever, 70 degrees Fahrenheit, a little bit warmer than the air around. And that would be great for root growth and stimulating growth within like seeds. So that could be something that you could look into. I don't love the greenhouse things with the zip fronts and things like that, but you might even be able to get crafty and build something that's very similar to that. So a question on the snake plant episode from Roz. You mentioned that you have some of them away from the southwest facing window towards the center of your apartment. How often do you water these in the winter? Very rarely, Roz. I mean, I actually watered one a bit too much during that time because there's not a lot of light and it started to rot one of the stems, unfortunately. So I would be mindful just like how much light you're actually giving your plants. And I would also tell you, this was a note that we've learned from Saunders' snake plant that he brought from his one apartment, which was in, I think, an eastern window, but below the window. So it wasn't getting a tremendous amount of light. Then we moved it into a southern window, really intense light. There's no cutting of the UV rays that come through these this window. And the plant got burned because I think it was just not accustomed to being in such high light conditions. So be mindful as you're kind of transitioning a plant from one place to another, especially even, I mean, that's why we get a lot of leaf loss when we actually bring things in from the nursery. So it's customary where you bring something in from the nursery, is probably grown in really intense light, and then you move it into your house and it takes about 2 weeks for a plant to acclimatize. And if it doesn't have a lot of light in the house, oftentimes they'll start to lose leaves and you're like, oh no, like leaf drop. So yeah, just be mindful of it. But to answer your question, you're usually watering it in relation to the amount and the intensity and the quantity and the quality of light that you're giving a plant. And so if it's in your interior space and you don't have a grow light on it, then you're probably going to be watering a lot less, because it's going to take the time to dry in the soil a lot longer. And honestly, I actually just read an article the other day in one of the growers magazines that I get. And I really liked the mindset that they were in. They basically said, you shouldn't think about watering a plant. You should think about needing the soil to dry. So the soil needs to dry out for a specific period of time before you start watering again. So they were talking it in relation to hiring people to water your plants in a greenhouse. But the guy was joking who wrote the article. And he said, basically, you should be paying people to watch your soil dry to the point that the plant just starts to wilt a little bit, and then you're able to actually water it again. So I thought that was like a really interesting way to think about watering a plant and learning when the soil is dry enough and the signs that the plant is showing in order to be able to water again. So maybe something that we could use indoors as well. So, yeah, by the way, Gregory, I'm going to shout you out if you're still here. It's 3 a.m. in Philippines and you're I don't know if you're a late night, you stay up late night or not, but thanks for staying up that late. Okay, so Sparshetti, any plants that are very hard to kill and could deal with low light? I'd say the ZZ plant, honestly. For me, the ZZ plant has been the number one plant in my interior that doesn't have a grow light on it. It doesn't grow a tremendous amount, but even the one that I have by the door, like when I first enter in, they have 2 new sprouts and that is getting very, very little light. So I highly recommend, I mean, a lot of people don't want to bring ZZ plants into their home because they are toxic to pets. So if you had some, you know, a pet that likes to nibble on some things, I'd be mindful of it. But I really like the ZZ plant. I can't recommend that enough. And then I would say Syndapsis pictus. I had moved that from my southwest facing window into my interior space without a grow light. And it's still growing like gangbusters. So those two for me are really good ones. Procris repens, a little easier to kill. It's also used to be known as Pelionia repens. It's an understory plant. So those are great. And I could also recommend like very hardy, usually green leaved, not the fancy ones, the aglaonemas. Those could be very good too, although they could become very stemmy. Not the red ones or the pink ones or the fancy white ones or anything. Those are not as hardy. So anyone have any questions for, okay, so I'm going to answer some flock questions. Suncat Strolls asks if I have been foraging on the homestead yet. No, unfortunately, no time for that. And it didn't really help that I kind of got here really at the tail end of the fall and into the winter. And we've been like stuck under about 4 to 5 feet of snow. It's not that you can't find things in the winter, but springtime is going to be a great time to forage, but we haven't really gotten a chance to be on this land yet and figure out even what's growing so much in the forest. We got some stuff in the fall. We found some mushrooms, but you know, the edible kind, but, we just got in the tail end. So hopefully. Did I already do a home tour? No, we have not done a home tour. We haven't done any of the building tours this week. I think on Tuesday, we're going to release a property tour. So you'll get to see a little bit of the landscape and some of our ideas that we're thinking. So you could stay tuned for that. And Rohith asks, will you build a greenhouse to house your collection? I don't know if we'll build a greenhouse big enough for the collection, but it is in the plans to actually build a greenhouse. And I think in thinking about a greenhouse, I have to think about of like, what type of greenhouse do I want? Like what kind of plants do I want to be growing in that? And that will also determine like where we put the greenhouse in the landscape and trying to figure out like what's the best place and is it going to be attached to a building? Like, is it going to be like a solarium? Is it going to be an extension of the house that I'm sitting in now? Or is it going to be on its own? And that will actually determine, you know, what kind of plants we want to grow in here. Because since we're in the four seasons here, and it gets very cold. So like half the year, it's very cold. You have to work with a glass or wherever, whatever you're going to be, facing the roof with, to handle 50 pounds of, snow, you know, on the roof. So you just have to, work with that. And of course you might have to heat it. And the heating costs could be ginormous. So you have to decide like, well, is it going to be tropical plants? Because then you really have to heat it. And if it's going to be succulents, you might have to heat it less. So those are all kinds of like things that are kind of running through our heads about what, you know, makes sense, what we'd be able to actually, you know, finance ourselves, how we could do it. How big it would be, how small it would be. You know, we don't actually have those answers yet, but we hope to actually share some of that thinking like on the channel as well as we kind of cross that bridge. Would I ever get any tropical indoor birds? That's from Ariel Grace. Yeah, I think like I think what I'm thinking about when I think about getting birds is I have such a soft spot for like what Wild Bird Fund is doing, which is a rehabilitation center in New York. There's a lot of rehabilitation, not enough, unfortunately, but there's rehabilitation centers for animals everywhere. And those are often like wild birds that are hurt or have like hit into a window, had a window collision, which is like a common thing. We've actually even had a couple window collisions here with birds. It's just been really a sad thing. So we're looking into like bird friendly glass options, which we started to realize as we were doing the research and talking with glass companies that it's such an unknown area for non-commercial residences. So that's been very interesting. But the reason why I bring it up is because I like the idea of taking birds that cannot go back to the wild or have been mishandled or mistreated and bringing them into the space. So I wouldn't say that we're going to be running a sanctuary or anything like that, but we'll have kind of like sanctuary values, I suppose, when it comes to that. But there's always people who are like tossing out chickens and other birds. And I think that we could maybe eventually, you know, give them a space. Any indoor tree-like plants that my budgies could perch on? Ooh, that's a good one. I mean, I would actually try like maybe some citrus trees if you have the light for it. And if you get a large enough citrus, that might be kind of cool. Some citrus have like little spikes on, but they're not that spiky, and budgies would be able to move around that. Yeah, I think that could be a good one because you could still get some miniature ones. I don't know how big of a tree that you're kind of looking for. I actually had, unfortunately, a calamondin citrus that came in and got stuck in transit, and it was like it got delivered here and it was like covered in snow and it didn't make it, unfortunately. So maybe get it. I don't know what part of the world that you're in, but you could probably get citrus during a time when it's not so cold out. Are you going to grow native plants? From Sheena Olon. Yes. In fact, there's a lot of non-native plants that are planted in this landscape. You will see them in the in the tour of the property. And I'm a big believer in actually growing a meadow here and taking out some of the lawn and planting like a lower meadow of native plants. I think that, man, it's a missed opportunity if you're not doing that. And there might actually be some funding from the state to actually create native pollinator meadows here because there's a move towards that. It works really well in agricultural environments as well. So if you have orchards or you're growing kind of like one crop, being able to intercrop with other plants is just going to be better for the pollinators and also for the biodiversity. And not just pollinators. I know we focus a lot on pollinators, but there's also other insects. Like so many of our bird species are dwindling. And it's largely because a lot of our bird species actually rely on caterpillars and other insects that can't live in a normal lawn. And, you know, about 40 million acres in the US is like just turned and converted to lawn. So it's like this really neutered landscape, right? So we have a lot of power, not just us, like anybody who has a little bit of lawn, we have a lot of power to be able to change that for our ecosystem. So I think that's something that we feel really passionate about and that we hope to do here. So how many houses are on the property? Are you all living in one house? That's from Diana. Hey Diana. So there are 5 structures on this property and there really is one livable place, which eventually we want to turn into a community place. Like a community place where we have, like, it has a big kitchen. We could come in here and we could actually use the kitchen, and have a seating area for everyone. So the idea is to like have homes in like a little enclave and then have a communal area, which, you know, this is not unusual. It's not unusual for this area. There's a lot of communal living here. I wouldn't say a lot, but there's enough that there's a precedence. And there's so many different ways to actually think about community living. I know I'm kind of going off on a little tangent, but I encourage people to at least look into it, because the more that I start delving into issues that we all face, you know, there's just an increase in renting. And, you know, I started reading some really compelling articles about like how, you know, we've become a renter's society. And there's this like term, well, renter's mentality, meaning like, if you're a renter, it's very hard to want to contribute to your community, because you can't really call anything your own. And you might be a part of your community and you might be putting a lot of effort into your community, like, you know, what like I was doing and the people in my area were doing in the community garden. And that actually increases the value of the area that you live, but you don't own anything. You don't have anything to call your own. And the landlords, which might be absentee landlords, are sitting on their own land and renting it out. And then they're just jacking up the rent more and more and more as you add value to the community. And I think that those principles like really, you know, speak to us. And I thought like for us to be able to come together and pool our resources to try to do this, I'd love to see more people be able to do that, because it's very empowering. But this has been done on large scales as well. Like there's community land trusts that really focus on folks who don't have a lot of land access, and how can you build homes for lower income communities? You know, some of the first community land trusts out of the US came out of the social justice movement and the civil rights movement in the 1960s. And it's kind of evolved from there. And I think now we have probably close to 1,000 community land trusts, both in rural and urban areas. But you could think about real estate trusts, you could think about communes, enclaves, like all these different types of communities. So yeah, so for us here, we have mainly like barns that we've been putting to use, but there isn't, you know, places where we could actually, you know, plant ourselves if we weren't on top. We'd just be roommates, you know, as we would be in like, you know, New York City. But we want to be more like land mates in this sense. But Lex, thank you so much. That's very sweet of you. You actually donated on the super chat. Okay. So he asks, last November, I acquired a gorgeous 8-year-old Hope Salome, which is a type of thematophyllum, used to be known as a philodendron, from a client's COVID-19 shutdown. 70% of her leaves turned yellow, crisp, and rust to her New England home. Thank you. Yeah, I don't know, Lex, I don't know if you saw the conversation that we had a little earlier, but oftentimes if you're moving a plant from one place to another, I also don't know if it happened during the winter months and if you had it nicely wrapped up and warm. Whenever there's a change from one place to another, it takes about a couple weeks for a plant to acclimatize, and leaf drop is really quite common. So I think what you're describing, with knowing that little bit of information, my guess is that it would be leaf drop. Thematophyllum and philodendron in general are pretty resilient. I would double check her roots just to make sure that the roots look healthy. So that might mean, I don't know how big it is, because it can get to be a big plant. Even if you just pull it out a little bit, just inspect the roots, feel around, make sure that they're not mushy, that there's nothing wrong with it. It might just be acclimatization. If you know what direction that light was facing, the type of light that she was getting, transitioning to more of that kind of light would be ideal. And I don't know what climate you're in. Glad that she was wrapped in a paper sleeve. That's very good. I don't know what kind of climate you were in, but in the springtime, which we're approaching spring, might be new hope, because for hope, because that's when they'll start putting out new growth. So I would wait until spring. I would, you know, give her a nice bright indirect light and check her roots, and wait through spring to see if it starts putting out new growth, because it just might be a light and temperature shift thing. So yeah, you're in 5B, so similar to us. I would just wait, you know, wait another month and see if it starts putting out new growth, because plants will have to lose all of their leaves in order to acclimatize to the new environment. And those new leaves that they put out are then going to be acclimatized to your conditions. So it's a really dramatic, and some don't bounce back, especially if you take it over the winter months. It bounces back more easily if it's during the growing season that you're able to, if you're able to kind of move. And that's one thing that I have in my mind. Somebody asked about like the plants that if I bring from one point to the other, I'd rather not bring the plants in the winter. I'd rather bring them, like if I were to bring them, I'd rather bring them in the spring or summer months when it's easier to transfer plants. Okay. That's interesting. So Farm Lancer interestingly says, in Soviet Union, there was a term, coal holes, K-O-L-H-O-Z, which means collective homestead. Yeah, I mean, it's amazing when you start to dive into this, like how to structure collective living, you know, more than just kind of thinking about it and dreaming about it. It's fascinating to see, you know, I have some books, I could recommend some books actually from like the 1800s that were written that have led to this kind of more modern day thinking about community land trusts and collective living and all this other kind of stuff. I mean, if you look at like Israel, you know, the Jewish National Trust, they have, you know, allowed people to do ground leases and more collective living. Like if you think about kibbutz living, right? And people have been doing like collective living for eons. You know, there's lots of cultures that do collective living, but how does it work in a more modern context? You know, those are the things that I think that, you know, you have to accept the where we are in life and in what modern context that we're living in. And so how does that work? And how does that work personally for the people who are choosing to do it? So I think that it's fascinating, especially when you see it in different cultures. So thank you so much for bringing that to light and to be giving it a name in your country. Ralph asks, how are you handling snow clearing on the property? Well, Ralph, luckily, we kind of missed the first couple snows. And the first snow, maybe it was the second snow, was massive. It was like 22 inches. Another area like south of us actually got 40 inches. It was massive. And we had to get an excavator. We had to hire somebody to excavate the snow, not like a snow plow, an actual excavator. And then we smartened up and we got a UTV. So with a plow, and that has come in it's come in handy. It's not like super powerful. So you have to go out multiple times a day when it's snowing in order to push like a few inches here and there. But we have used it nonstop. I mean, this has been one of the snowiest winters in this area. Actually, there's somebody who lives next to us that's has been here for 27 years, and he says this is the most snow that he's seen in 27 years. So, yeah. So do you and your homestead partners, Suncat Strolls asked, do you and your homestead partners have certain roles? If so, what are they? We actually talked about roles in the beginning when we really didn't know who was going to do what. And that's an important conversation to have. It became pretty clear that Sonder wanted to be here full time and be more of like the property manager, if you will. Also he works with like on the finance side of things to make sure that the finances all work out and everything. So he does like projections and predictions. And then, Joey couldn't be here very much because his work has him all over the world. And he's right now finishing up a book in Ethiopia. So he's out there. So in a way, he knows and we know and again, this is just managing expectations, that he's more of a silent partner right now. And he recognizes that as well. And that's okay. And then my role is really a connector. So making sure that if we have, like, we had some soil tests and soil surveys done here, you know, bringing on the forester to come out and take a look at the forest land, you know, perhaps like calling some of the folks who actually had built some of the buildings to understand some of those plans. I do a bit more of that. And I think that our roles have come easy to us because that's more of what we like to do. I think as we start to build, Saunders probably also, because he comes from a more architectural and carpentry background, and that's something that he wants to explore more of, he'll be taking on some more of that role as well. So I think that those roles are going to shift and change over time, especially as we start to settle in here a bit more. But for right now, those are kind of the roles. And if you ever think about doing this with partners or other people, highly recommend managing your expectations. One of the questions that we had asked ourselves and we put together in something that we call a partnership charter was, what are your expectations for yourself? And what do we think other people's expectations are of us? And then we asked our other partners what they expect of us as well. So by actually talking through that, we were able to come up with a deeper understanding for each other. So how did you find your resources for land inspection? Wild Cactus 248. I'm not quite sure what that means. Like resources, meaning like how did we find out somebody for a land to inspect, like the tools and stuff? I mean, we got a recommendation for an inspector for the homes. And then we got we knew somebody in the area who could walk the land with us, who usually does inspection of sites. And we had him, his name is Craig, he walked the land with us. And then we started to find tools for finding land as we were going through the process. I mean, I think I might've said this in the videos. I wish we actually knew some of these tools earlier on, but like Onyx Hunt was a great app that we ended up using. We only found that like halfway through our search because another real estate agent was actually using it. And we're like, what is that tool that you're using? And she's like, oh, this is a hunting app. All the real estate agents kind of use this. And then we started to map things out on, you know, Google Maps and everything like that. And then we were like, oh my God, these are getting way too detailed. I wish we had some other kind of tool. Now, I actually used to do ArcGIS and GIS, Geographic Information Systems, in university. And Sandra had brought it up. He's like, well, maybe we should do something like GIS. And I was like, oh my God, like I should call my professor, Art Lembo. He's no longer a professor here up at Cornell, but he's down in Maryland now. And we called him and took his course and started to map things out, because this area has a lot of information that could be mapped out. And that became like a really easy tool for us. So we learned as we go, and we shared some of those tools with you. And hopefully that actually helps. Matt, thank you so much. Matt actually is a wonderful guy who we just met through this whole area. He's actually building greenhouses himself. Very nice to see you there. Is that like a tea? A little guy with a tea? Cheers. Okay, I have this nettle tea because Jay asked about it. I love this. Not sponsored by them. Would love to be sponsored by them, but this is like the most delicious tea. Don't be turned off to nettle. Like they have peppermint and vanilla in it. It's really delicious. Neil, honey, will you allow or want volunteers or woofers to help out? I love that idea. And I know so many of my friends have actually gone woofing, and it's changed their perspective on life. We just kind of got here, and I was just having this conversation with Joey and Sandra the other day. We want to have more ways for you all to be able to interact rather than just online and on YouTube. But we have to kind of get our feet on the ground first and figure it out. and do some renovations and some changes here, and then set it up to a place where I think we could get people maybe come and do workshops or volunteerships or like woofing. So many different possibilities. And we just have to kind of like let the year unfold. And I think we're going to really hit the ground running when it comes to be like May, June, July, because that's when we could actually start planting and planning, and we're not under so much snow and probably water, because in the spring it gets really wet and muddy here. So yes, I think the short answer is yes. We want that to actually happen, but it's probably not going to come right away. So Austin asks, Todd says woofing. So yes, that is like basically when you go, I can't even remember what it stands for. Does anybody remember what it stands for? You basically go out and you volunteer on a farm, and you have like a farm internship, and you could go to, there's like an organization, like woof.org or whatever. And, okay. Yes. Worldwide opportunities on organic farming. Thank you. You could go anywhere in the world, and it's a nice collective, and you could get an experience of working in a biodynamic farm or a permaculture farm or an organic farm or non-organic farm. So, it's usually organic farms. So you could go and have that experience. And they're all over the world. So I would recommend anybody who's interested in that to check it out. Also, if you have state assisted colleges in your area, they might have information on helping people with internship opportunities and small farm opportunities. So for anybody who's looking to make a change in their life. Okay, Austin, thank you, Summer Rayne. What are the collective living books you recommend? Yes, I actually, let me just pull out some already. Hold on, I'm right back. What is that one that I was reading? I have no idea where I put it. It's right there. Okay. This is only a small section because I'm not going to run around trying to find every single one. This is amazing. The Community Land Trust Handbook. This came out in the 80s. It's like the latest one is the 80s. It's so old. But believe it or not, this book came out of this area right here, out of the people coming together and trying to figure out how more people could have access to land and be able to build their dreams. So I highly recommend this one. It's the most like modern day. Then there's this one, The Small Community, Foundations of Democratic Life. Basically, I'm kind of going back in time because I like when I come to a more modern day concept, I want to see how that has been formed, because a lot of these ideas had been formed over millennia, right? And they're borrowed from other people, and then they're slightly changed to fit with like a more modern context and a more modern way of living. This was like one of the Ebenezer Howard. He was like one of the early guys who started thinking about this, is Garden Cities of Tomorrow. Now you might remember like Singapore is called like a garden city and a city in a garden. And they had like these little maps of how like a community living could actually work and how it would be structured. So a lot of these thinkers of the time kind of got really interested in one of these people's thoughts and kind of kicked the ball down from there. And actually the first like community land trust, I had mentioned this, came out of the civil rights era in the 1960s, partially because they met up with this guy by the name of Ralph Borsodi and Bob Swan, who came up with this concept, the modern day concept of a community land trust. What we're doing here is not a community land trust. I just want to be, upfront about that. It's more like an enclave, that kind of thing. And we have a plan to open up part of it to the community in some way, shape, or form. But we kind of want to get stuck in the community a little bit and kind of figure that out and how that works. So you just got, I think you have to kind of feel what works for you and as a crew, if you're going to be doing it with a crew. Okay. So Samuel says, is the homestead you are starting like a mini community and will you have animals so you can become self-sufficient? I think I answered this question in one of my first videos, but yeah, there's a few of us that have come together. We realized that we probably couldn't do this on our own unless we actually pooled our resources. So that's part of what we did is we pooled our resources. And I actually like had to petition a friend to borrow some of those resources because I didn't have that enough to kind of come in as an equal partner. So I'm now paying off my debt to that person. So you have to kind of like work it out. I've talked about this on the episode. I don't think it's feasible for us to be that we're thinking about a self-sufficient homestead. And the reason for that is I think that we're just, I think personally, all of us are like way too modern. Like we love going to restaurants. I like going and supporting like local restaurants and going out, like our friends do a pizza thing. Like we go out and buy their pizzas and stuff like that. But the idea and working towards more of that goal is what appeals to us. A lot of those principles and those values appeal to us. I was like talking to a woman here and I was like, it'd be great, you know, just do a hobby farm. And she's like, don't call it a hobby farm. Cause if you're farming, you're farming, you know, whether it's your hobby or not, it's just a farm. And I like that, you know, because once you start doing that kind of stuff, you get really into it. So, yeah, the idea is to actually have, some homes, picture it as like maybe two sections where we have like a small community of homes and then a communal living space. And then opening up the other section to the community in some way, shape, or form. And I don't know, that could take into many different shapes. Like maybe we do a local farmer's market here. Like maybe we do, I don't know, like movies on Saturdays. Maybe it becomes a little market. I have no idea because we just want to be open-minded about that. And then maybe we'll have places where people could come and stay. Maybe there's going to be residencies. We're all kind of creative, so angling it more towards people who want to come and create and collaborate together kind of seems interesting to all of us, but that's the fun part. Like we don't have to have anything set in stone right yet. But yeah, I think animals, agroforestry, permaculture, gardening, all of that kind of stuff is really resonates with me personally and the rest of my partners. So you'll probably see more of that come to fruition here. Dylan, I was wondering how you find out which plants are native to your area for planting outside. I mean, I wouldn't want to introduce invasive species, and he lives in the Netherlands. Well, very good. So I grew up in this area actually. So I grew up about an hour and a half, from this area. So I feel very aware of the landscape. I think I have to brush up a little bit on my botanical nomenclature for the outdoor plants. I'm a little rusty. So if I just dust off those cobwebs, but it comes back really quickly. So I think I have a good relationship with the plants in the area. In fact, when I did a walkthrough on this property, I was able to identify what was really invasive and what was not. And we started taking out some of the invasives. I would love to reintroduce plants if I could find them available that are endangered or threatened in this landscape. I have started to do some research on where I could actually find those, and they're not always available. So I think that will be kind of an interesting thing to try. And part of this area was really kind of torn up. So I'm very much looking forward to actually restoring that landscape. And I'm not sure the best way how to do that quite yet, but that's actually something I used to do as well, is restore landscapes, really like really beat up landscapes. So, but you know, I'm willing to take advice from other people who might have more experience because I have stepped away from that for so long. So yeah, so that's good. All right, guys, I'm going to try to take a few more questions because we are at this for an hour now. I can't believe it. But you guys have such amazing questions. Maya Popova asks, can you please talk about houseplants behave differently indoors versus in the wild? Yeah, I mean, look, like a plant is in a container. And usually when we talk about substrate in an indoor plant, it's completely sterilized. We don't talk about substrates in the form of sand, silt, and clay, which when we talk about the substrates outside, right, or soil outside, we don't even call it substrate outside, we call it soil. It's like what percentage is sand, silt, and clay. And it has a wealth of life in those, in the soil, which you don't have in a sterilized potting medium, right? So that's one thing. These roots are not really developing mycorrhizal relationships in the same way that they would be outdoors. So the nutrients to those plants are probably not being shuttled by some of those relationships that the plant has with maybe the archaea, the bacteria, and the mycorrhizae, and some nematodes, because there's some beneficial nematodes, there's some that are not so beneficial, right? So that's a big thing. And, you know, a lot of things are wind pollinated, right? So if I have this peperomia here, this peperomia grows a really tall flower spike that's wind pollinated. So if you don't have that in your house, you know, it's probably not going to exchange its pollen from one place to the other. And that's fine. We can enjoy the flowers as is. The other thing is you have your roots are really restricted in a small pot. It could happen. Restricted roots could actually happen outdoors too. That's why they tell you when you're planting a tree or something, not to backfill it with like really amazing topsoil and stuff like that. They want you to use people suggest to use the same soil that you have that tree in, that you're growing in your landscape, because otherwise that tree will girdle itself. It'll stay in that nice soil that you have given it. The same thing could happen with these. They could girdle themselves. Probably not peperomia, because they're so used to growing in a very tiny environment. But you want to be mindful and be able to, you know, grow the roots out. But you could probably girdle a lot easier with a plant indoors that is not given enough root space. And the one thing that you can do about, you know, indoor plants is oftentimes when we think about leaf matter falling on plants outdoors, that helps protect the soil and it helps protect roots from weeds, from freezing temperatures, that kind of stuff. But if dead matter is falling onto your plant indoors, you usually want to clean it up, because there's no way for that to break down. It'll just probably get like some kind of bacterial fungal infection. So you want to remove some of that dead and decaying leaves, when oftentimes outdoors you could just let that sit, because it could cycle through the whole chain, if you will, or the whole cycle. So plants indoors and plants outdoors, they react very differently. I also think, like, when you get pests, mealybugs, aphids, if you put your plant indoors, if it has aphids and you could shuttle it outdoors to a protected area, you know, don't put it outdoors now if you're in the north and it's cold, like you're going to kill your plant. But if you could put it out in a protected area, sometimes the native beneficial insects will actually find that plant and take care of those insects. That's not something that you could always get indoors. So the reaction and the interaction is very different. And I think that the tips that I could give you for an indoor plant would be very different from, you know, the tips for outdoor plants. Dylan, he doesn't know where to start finding native plants in your area. A good place to start is like books in your area, perhaps. If there's, you know, sometimes it's field guides to native plants in your areas, you could start there. Another great place to go, I don't know where you are, but like if you have extension offices, you're in the Netherlands, if you have extension offices with your universities, we have that, you know, in the United States. I don't know if you have it in your universities out there, but oftentimes if you go into environmental programs or extension offices within those universities, they have some of that information. I mean, I think, like, honestly, the Netherlands is so changed over that, you know, the landscape has been so changed that it might actually be challenging to find some of the native plants. But that's where I would start. My extension office, universities, books, you know, going to your library and actually looking at native plants. Also, I would say go to the botanic gardens. And I think that Hortus actually had a really, you know, they were like one of the earlier botanical gardens, and they looked at medicinal plants, and they had like a really big medicinal plants. They probably have some stuff on native plants as well there. And they might actually even have a library. I don't know if they do or not, but that could be a good place to actually work. Oh, so Chelsea, tips for planting a native garden, like what and where to plant things. You know, I could tell you how I'm kind of thinking about native plants. I'm looking and observing the landscape here. And I see some areas that are much more wet meadow, some that are near ponds, and some that are drier. And I've taken some soil tests, and that really informs what kind of plants could be planted where. I'm looking at the aspect that some of the topography is facing. So whether it gets sun all day long and it gets beaten down with sun, or if it's in a more shady area, that will start to help you map out what plants could be planted where. So for instance, if I was planting a native garden in the shady parts of the woods, that's going to be extremely different than the boggy areas with the pond that's in sun all day long. And, you know, I think typical things that I would plant in a shady area could be lily of the valleys and a lot of ferns and maybe some types of like Virginia bluebells and gingers, asarum, like Canadense, like things like that, that could tolerate growing in trout lilies is another one that could tolerate growing in shadier conditions that are usually spring ephemerals oftentimes. And then if I think about pond and boggy areas, you have to have something that can manage having wet feet, right? And you look at some of the plants that are already growing there. So when I was walking here in the fall, I saw a lot of asters. I saw boneset. I saw solidago. I was thinking, ooh, I could actually probably start planting some blue flag iris, some Joe pieweed, things that I have seen in like wet meadows, right? Cardinal flowers maybe. And then in the drier areas where there could be a meadow, I would start thinking grasses. What are some of the native grasses that you could possibly plant? So I think that's how you start. It's almost like painting. You create a palette. This is where I create spreadsheets. I actually created another spreadsheet that I started to use where I mapped out all the native species that I could possibly think about in the area. And I list, like, do they need to be in intense sun? What kind of soil mediums do they prefer? Like, and how much water? That's the same. It's almost the same thing that I did for my like plant care spreadsheets indoors. How much light do they need? What type of substrate? How much water? And then I could sort the spreadsheet by those conditions. And then I could find the palette of plants that I could actually paint with, right? So I could say, oh, okay. You could even then put more, I have like more detailed columns where I'm like, this grows 2 feet high and this grows 3 feet high and this grows like 6 inches high, right? Because you don't want to plant a 6-inch plant in between two plants that grow 3 feet high. You're going to miss out on that 6-inch plant. So that's how like my mind thinks. I want to organize it. And so that's how I'm kind of thinking about planting native plants here. So hopefully that helps you think about it. Leo, he started the masterclass. Congratulations. That's fun. How did I learn so much about plants? I learned from doing the YouTube channel. I've learned a lot since doing the YouTube channel in the last 4 years. I learned from other people. I have an education in this, but that doesn't mean like I've learned like everything from that. It definitely helps. And you just have a passion for it. When you have a passion for these things, when you're a kid, you know, I see a lot of folks who write me now who are like 10, 11, 12 years old, and they really love plants. And it's like so amazing when you could be so young and learn about plants at the, know that you, that's what you're interested in, and then go and spend the rest of your life kind of learning those things and fulfilling that passion. That's awesome. So I think as long as you have this interest and this passion, you just want to keep on learning because you'll just always learn. And what I hope to do with like Plant One On Me and hopefully with Flock Finger Lakes is that, you know, I learn as I go and I want to share that with you. And I always tell folks, I said this in the 365 Days of Plants, do not take my stuff as gospel. Like what I learn may be totally different in your, where you are, or even, and will be very different if even in your own landscape, even if it's in the same area, because the conditions that I have here are going to be very different than yours. So I just hope that you take the information that you learn from me, and it could be a really nice foundation for you to learn even more on yourself. So I think that's, or by yourself. So thank you. And I hope you enjoy the rest of the masterclass. So my current temperature is ranging between 20 and 35 degrees Celsius. Wow, that is hot. That's hot. That's like what, 70 degrees Fahrenheit? With humidity of 20 to 50%. That's a really good, that's a strong humidity. 30, anything lower than 30 is getting a little too dry for most subtropical plants. Do I need a humidifier for my tropical plants in the balcony? Thank you so much. 20 to 30, as long as it's like, that's kind of on the low end, anything between that 30 and 50 range is really nice. It just depends. Like, it's not like your plant is going to like die, you know, if it's 20 to 30% for a little while, you know, it's, the humidity fluctuates all the time, but I would just be mindful of it and see if it's like crisping up or anything along those lines. So I would, you know, I would take a look at that. But I don't know if you need a humidifier. It's hard to know if you get a lot of sun, if that sun is really heavy and burning. The thing with a humidifier is if you get one, you might have to water a lot less because humidity brings up the moisture levels in the air, and then you could water your plants less. So I don't know. It's something to think about. I got a little humidifier back here that I started to use on my one fern plant because in the heat of the winter in the house, it gets really crispy. Do I have any tips for raising humidity without a humidifier? I don't know if you just saw my closet tour. I have these humidity mats that I use to water my plants, and I have them all clustered together, and the water evaporates and it transpires not only from the plants, but from the base of the humidity mat. I can't tell you how much that has increased the humidity around my plants, but that's part of what it's used for. So that would be a analog version, I would say, from the humidity. Okay, so Matt asks, I planted a bunch of aloe in the greenhouse from a friend's large plant. They are yellow brownish. Ruled out overwatering. Is it also climatization? Hard to know. Do they have roots, Matt? Does the plant actually have roots? Did you cut them off? Because yeah, I would rule out overwatering too. You probably shouldn't be watering them if they don't have any roots. But yellow brown, it could be acclimatization. It could be too cold. Maybe not. Maybe if it's in the greenhouse. But aloe doesn't like to get below 50 degrees Fahrenheit or 10 degrees Celsius. I doubt that it's that cold in your greenhouse. And if it doesn't have spots, then I would rule out anything that's fungal or bacterial. But make sure if you ruled out overwatering because you're not watering them because they don't have roots, I would just wait. Aloes are pretty resilient if you give it enough, as long as like they're not below 50 degrees Fahrenheit. So I'm sorry, I wish I had more information for you. I just got aloes in. Somebody sent me some aloes, and they're brown and mushy because they put them out without a heat pack. And so I know that is they just got cold temperature, and I could tell you that much, but for the yellow and brown, not quite sure. Somebody said, open aquarium is good for humidity. That's a great solution. If you want some fish, And sometimes they put the plants like right over the aquarium. That's also very cool. So yeah. Okay, so somebody says plant lady. Someone, I really want to go, but like honestly, you guys are such great questions. These are great questions. Plant Lady Ang, I'm a mental health therapist who also loves plants and the relationships between people and the ecosystems. Do you know of any bridges between my field and ecology? I'm changing fields. Absolutely. Take a look at horticultural therapy or therapeutic horticulture. So, you know, I think that's an incredible line that ties in both of what you're trying to do. And maybe you could even become a landscape designer that focuses on specifically designs that help with mental health, or for people who are going through some health struggles. It doesn't even have to be mental health. Like oftentimes therapeutic gardens are done near hospitals and things along those lines. So if I had your background, I think that's more of what I would, you know, focus on. Anyway, guys, I have to get going, but you have so many great questions. Let's do this again. Saunders is actually moderating and has copied down a number of other wonderful questions that you guys have asked so that I could start with those questions, just like I did today. I'm going to start with those questions in the next live stream, but you guys are amazing. Thank you so much for tuning in. Such great questions on Flock, and I hope that you'll enjoy the property tour that we're launching this week. And I hope it answers more questions and inspires you to kind of just like think about living a little differently, and more to come. Bye guys. Very much love to you. Love you guys.